I told you the relative size of Africa on world maps is completely wrong. My short video was extremely popular, gaining millions of views across my platforms. As much as I got wonderful messages from people who, like me, didn't know this detail about our representation of the world, there were many naysayers. One of the most popular accusations was that I was implying racism and prejudice as the reason for the misrepresentation, and that the map was the way we've seen it because of basic geometrical constraints. In other words, there simply was no way for this misrepresentation of Africa not to happen. As such, I want to make this clear. I'm not implying racism and prejudice as the reason for how we've been taught to view Africa on world maps. I'm categorically stating it as fact. To provide evidence of this, we're going to look at this topic in more depth than my 1 minute video could manage. I'm going to tell you about the true size of Africa, why the most widely used map was distorted, who distorted it, and most importantly, why most systems of education and media still don't use a more accurate representation of the world. Developing a thriving community to uncover hidden African history, stimulate critical thinking, and build bridges between Africa and the diaspora requires resources. It cannot be done without you. Consider joining our Patreon family to support my work, where you can watch ad-free videos early, utilize the chat feature, participate in Patreon-only live shows, and be a part of my creative process. Visit the Patreon link at themerc.io, pick your membership tier, and let's make history together. Pay attention. Most of us were first introduced to the visual representation of the world in classrooms, and we're used to seeing Africa in relation to the rest of the world on flat maps. While Africa isn't small on those maps, it seems equatable to all the other continents. This presentation is completely wrong in terms of the relative size of Africa compared to other landmasses, specifically those in the Northern Hemisphere. Africa has been the subject of fascination, exploration, and misunderstanding for centuries. Its minerals and resources have also made it the constant target for exploitation. This exploitation hasn't been reserved to physical riches, but also the way the continent is perceived. Africa is acknowledged as the second largest continent on Earth behind Asia. This means, on paper, it should look larger than any other continent other than Asia. This is not the case. Regardless of this, some will say, who cares what the size of Africa truly is? This sentiment is disingenuous and usually comes from non-Africans with ingrained perceptions of the world. People who do not benefit from a corrected awareness of Africa's true relative size. Humans are affected by visual appearance. Size is one of the most impactful visual triggers for our species. In the animal kingdom, smaller animals are intimidated by larger animals. This is a generally accepted reality. The fact is, size inspires awe. A cat to a mouse is terrifying, but not to us. A lion to us is terrifying, but not to an elephant. If a man lives in a bungalow with a small garden, it doesn't have the same effect on his guests as if he lived in a mansion on 100 acres of land. Whether you respect him or not for living in that mansion, you will have an instinctive reaction. As such, when you realize the insane size of Africa in relation to the rest of the world and how it should actually look on the map, you will be absolutely astonished. Maps have been the primary method used to represent our world. However, we've been too quick to trust what we see. The map we've all used utilizes the Mercator projection and is named after a man called Gerardus Mercator, who created it in 1569. This is what you will see in most classrooms and textbooks. However, this map distorts the size of continents near the poles, making them appear larger than they are. In addition, continents near or on the equator were more difficult to represent, and that led to a significant underestimation of Africa's true size. Africa and other landmasses on the equator are actually the closest to their actual size because they experience the least distortion in the Mercator projection. The best way of thinking about this is that a continent like Africa is a certain size, but then everything to the north and south of it is stretched due to the curvature of the globe, and thus appears much larger in relation to Africa when pulled to create a rectangular map. So let's look at the actual numbers. Africa spans over 30 million square kilometers, 11.7 million square miles. Africa is nearly twice the size of the United States. You could fit the entire European Union inside Africa and still have room to spare. Even the vast expanse of China fits comfortably within Africa's borders. Despite the modern knowledge of how these factors misrepresent Africa, nothing has been done to correct it in the educational system. This misrepresentation continues to shape perceptions of the continent. So why are we still using the Mercator projection? This is where things get interesting. The Mercator projection wasn't primarily created to directly undermine Africa's size. However, it was a secondary effect that was very much welcome. The Mercator projection was designed for nautical navigation at sea and drawn along colonial trade routes. It allowed for straight lines between destinations that were used by colonialists so that ships could chart travel accurately. The map you all learned with was designed to make the transport of human and mineral resources for colonizers more efficient. This meant that Britain was placed at the center of the world to make it seem more intimidating, and the anchor for everything else in orbit around it. This is why when you look at the map, the UK is right in the middle, which created an aura of power during the time of the British Empire's apex and domination of the seas. This made places like Greenland look enormous and places like Indonesia appear tiny. In fact, as I stated, the most accurate maps you can get are not flat maps, but globes. However, globes are impractical to use for education and impossible to use in 2D literature. Now, one of the main criticisms of my original video was that the use of the Mercator map was not motivated by any kind of prejudice against Africa. This was a misdirection by those detractors. My issue isn't why the distortion exists. I've explained why, and that the reason is not motivated by bias, but caused by geometry. My issue is why it was never corrected for the map in education and mainstream use. Let's look at the facts, and you can come to your own conclusions. The Mercator projection was made for sea navigation in an era when ships were the primary means of international travel. That hasn't been the case for decades. Why would you use a seafaring map in a classroom, textbooks, and media? Because you had to. Because you couldn't create a more accurate flat map. Not the case. There were other more accurate projections. Many, many of them. I was able to find over 20 map projections. They all have strengths and weaknesses, and none of them are perfect. However, there were a number that addressed the relative size issue directly. The Eckert 4 projection designed by Max Eckert in 1906, the Mulwead projection by Carl Mulwead in 1805, the Good Homolocene projection by John Good in 1923. All of these show Africa closer to its true relative size as compared to other land masses. So this idea that there were no other options by the 20th century is untrue. However, I'm going to focus on another projection and the most popular antagonist to the Mercator. In 1855, clergyman James Gall presented a projection of the world that was more accurate to relative size. He then published his work in 1885. Now, for some reason, this projection, which showed continents and landmasses in a more accurate relative size, was not used or embraced by the mainstream. In fact, it pretty much disappeared for nearly 100 years as the world continued to push the Mercator projection. In 1973, a German filmmaker called Arno Peters independently came up with a similar projection to James Gall. Again, his projection showed Africa much larger in relative size to other landmasses. Some geometric errors aside, once again, there was a map that was more accurate in relativity in an era of disco, Star Wars, air travel, and Hollywood. Regardless, once again, the mainstream did not replace the Mercator projection with this projection, even though pretty much no one traveled by sea by the 70s unless you were going on a cruise specifically for that experience. And you most certainly didn't need a paper map for navigation with the technology available by the 70s. Thus, the argument of it was done for sea navigation is ludicrous. We're at a stage in human history that people are talking about commercial flights to the moon and Mars, yet we're still using a colonialism seafaring map from the 1800s for education. Arno Peters argued that the overuse of the Mercator projection was motivated by racism and prejudice against poorer nations and continents, which happened to be on or below the equator, specifically Africa and South America. He said North America and Europe refused to use his projection because they wanted to continue to promote the grossly exaggerated relative size of their nations compared to those in Africa and South America. Ironically, Africa relative to South America on the Mercator projection is quite accurate. because both happened to be near the equator. In 1986, cartographer Arthur H. Robinson combined the projections of James Gall and Arno Peters to call it the Gall-Peters projection. But yet again, it wasn't embraced by educational media representations of the world. The 80s is when I was in school, and I was taught the world looked like the Mercator projection. At this stage, there were options, and a German was arguing vehemently that the Mercator was obsolete and that its continued use was blatant Western prejudice against Africa and South America. You can read extensively about Arno Peters' protests and fight with cartographic associations over this issue. It got so bad that 7 North American geographic associations, rather than embrace the Gall-Peters projection, decided to reject all rectangular maps. That is telling that for 100 years, they were willing to teach children using maps that showed the Northern Hemisphere much larger than it was. Yet the idea of using maps showing Africa and South America as large as they should be prompted them to scrap the entire idea of flat maps in the classroom. That is astonishing. The North American Cartographic Information Society refused to endorse this resolution entirely anyway. They simply said, "We're not changing anything." When the Boston Public Schools introduced the Gall-Peters map in 2017, they said that students were astonished to see Africa appear so large in relation to Europe and the US, and that it changed their perspective of the African continent. What happened with the Mercator projection was not an accident. It was argued about ferociously within the cartographer community, while millions of people around the world continued to be misled by what they were taught. So to all those who say there was no prejudice against Africa with how the use of this map was handled, the facts are most definitely not on your side. Like, subscribe, comment, and share if you found this video informative.